For now, Wieske, would you step on stage, get to the floor, and say something about yourself and the work you're doing with Expeditie Anton?
Why do I start with? Staat hij niet aan? Oh.
Ja, hij staat nu aan.
Ik zal proberen stil te blijven staan. Nu wel? Gaat nou beter? Ja? Oké, okay, top. Why assumptions? We all have them. We all do. I assume things. You all assume things. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing. But if we don't test it, then I think it's a bad thing. And design thinking is all about getting away of our own assumptions. You want to know what your users want, what they need, what their wishes are, but most importantly, what their pains are. So what do they don't like? What do they maybe want in the future? If there is no pain that you can respond to, an idea can never be a solution. This picture, I think, says enough. The architect or whoever designed this path thought people would walk this way. He assumed people would take this road. But if he would have tested it, if he would have shown the people, they always take the shortest way. You know that. I will walk this way as well. And I think that's design thinking is all about. Just testing what you think, testing what your, or asking what your users want, what your target groups want. So how do we do that? Or how do I do that? I'm part of an innovation team called Expeditie Anton. It's the innovation team of Eindhoven, of the Public Library of Eindhoven. We are only with 3 members, so not 100, but we try to do the same thing with 3. And we are a group of thinkers and doers who work in the field of library users, technology, design and knowledge. I will tell you something about how we use design thinking, the methods we use, how we gather these pains or how we get to know the needs of our users. And how do we do that? We always stay curious. We are always seeking for new opportunities, new problems. We want to improve our services. We talk to people. We arrange focus groups. So a lot of being curious about the world around you, not only in the library, but especially outside of the library. And how does it look like? Also very, a lot of sticky notes. We created a lab, an innovation lab, because we really like to visualize our ideas and the way we work. That's our way of communicating with each other. So this is a whole room full of sticky notes and ideas and research we've done. So I will tell you about a few concepts that we created and that we realized or that we are realizing right now. And it's all based on the pains of our users or the pains of our target groups. I will explain later we use painstorming instead of brainstorming. The first one is what's next. Based on data, we give book suggestions at the Public Library of Eindhoven. So it's sort of like your Netflix recommendations that you can get on your profile. If you don't know what to read next, there is a lot. There are a lot of books. What do you want to read next? You can just scan your book, or you can fill in a title or an author, and the tool will give you new recommendations based on data of other people who also read that book. So it's now we created a prototype, and now it's in our realization phase. So it's actually a real tool that we can put in our library to test it. The next one is called Verse Leeswaren. I've tried to come up with an English name, but I think this is it says it all. It's a fresh reading box, fresh box of books, I don't know. It's a book, a box filled with 3 brand new books, and we deliver them and we pick them up. You don't need a subscription, you don't have to be a member of the library. You just pay one time and you get 3 new books for 3 months. And later on, I will tell you on which pain we try to respond to. The third one is re-library. At our library, we have a box where we sell books that are written off. So we can't lend them out anymore, and we sell them, maybe 1 euro, 2 euros, 5 euros max. If they don't get sold, we throw them away. That's a big pain. If you work for a library, you don't want to throw away your books. It hurts. We assumed that nobody wanted the books. We thought they have stamps on it. They have been written a lot. We just have to throw them away because we can make nobody happy with it. So we assumed that. But because we work with design thinking, we don't see our assumption as reality. We want to test it. We want to know if there maybe is a market for this these kind of books. So we created an account on bol.com, and we just put 50 books on it, educational books, art books, anything you can think of. And in the first week, we sold 3 books, and the highest price for one book was 40 euros. And if we kept it in a box at our library, it would be sold for 2 euros or for nothing. So it's a big difference. So this goes very well, it's very successful. And our last one is called EHV Every Day. And Eindhoven is a city with a lot of internationals and expats. Every year they're coming more and more. And as a library, we weren't really feeling the connection with this this target group. And especially the internationals, because expats are coming to Eindhoven, maybe live there for a year, 2 years, and then go back home or to another city, another country. And the internationals are coming to Eindhoven. They buy a house here. They started a family. They want to be involved in the city. They want to get to know locals. They want to get to know the city. And we thought about how can we provide something to make them feel more at home. So we didn't come up with a solution that directly linked the internationals to the library, but first of all, make them feel more at home at the city, make them know Eindhoven better. And if we improved our program, or if we can create an international program, of course, we want to connect them to our library. But first, the main goal was, or the biggest pain we got back from the internationals was to make them more feel more at home. So AFA Every Day is an online platform that provides 3 things to do every day in the city. It's something, some place to eat, some place you can go, or some activity you can join. And these are the 4 concepts that we are now creating. And we are doing this by brainstorming. So of course we do the brainstorming further on in the process, but brainstorming is very important for us because we want to know what people don't like. It's maybe a bit weird, but like Sitzel told, if you ask what do you like, people can come up with some things and they are not really new. But if you ask what do you don't like, or what do you miss, or what would you, mostly what do you don't like, where is the pain in your story, then you can create a solution. So the pain, it stands for people, activities, insights and needs. You want to know who these people are, you want to know what they do in the weekends, how they spend their evenings, why do they come to the library or why not. The insights you get from it are the bigger pains, are the smaller pains, are there maybe different pains, and of course the needs and what the solution may be. And if you look at the 4 concepts I just explained, we all developed them from a pain of the users. And these are the pains. The first one, of course, over choice, because there are a lot of books, there are a lot of books you can read, but which one will be your next book? Over choice. Verse leeswaren, it's about distance. We had to shut down 9 smaller libraries around Eindhoven. So for a lot of people, the distance, it was too far. They couldn't come to us, so why not come to them? We bring books to you, and we also pick them up. Bol.com, the re-library, of course, waste. You don't want to throw them away. It hurts. It hurts with the users, but also very at the organizations itself. And the last one, connection, the missing connection of internationals with the city and with locals and with other internationals. But that's not it. You want to know what your users want. You want to know what they need and what their pains are. But besides that, you have to be curious about the society, about your city, about other cities, other libraries. And importantly, benchmarking. You want to know what other companies are doing, other organizations that are not libraries. They maybe have the same problem and already have a solution for it. You can just not directly copy it, but you can implement it in your own organization. I don't know if somebody knows, but the McDrive is a very good example of benchmarking, because of course McDonald's didn't invent it themselves, the McDrive. To go with the car, you get a quick service, you get your food, and then you go further. Does anyone know where they got it from? Maybe? Totally different branch, totally different organization? No? They got it from the pit stop. Very easy. It's the same problem. You want to go somewhere, you want to have a quick service, and you want to go further. So it's the same thing. So that's very interesting to learn from other organizations. So that's what we do. Like the What's Next, we saw it on Netflix, or Verse Leeswaren. You have the HelloFresh boxes. It's the same, but with books. And to make it more clear, we created a timeline also to help other libraries, to help them improve or help them to innovate. And here you can see a few steps of design thinking, the preparation, inspiration, ideation, and implementation. These are all tools we use, like the interviews, but also shadowing or organization focus groups or immersing. To connect with internationals, we signed up at an expert fair as internationals, so we had a little bit of acting. And you talk to people, and you don't talk to them from throughout the library, like, hey, I'm working for a library, I want to know what you need. No, I'm also an expert, I just want to get to know you. And like in 10 minutes, you get invited for birthday parties and whatever. And it's a really cool way to connect with your target groups. Of course, brainstorming. It's a very big part of our method or the way we work. And what's also very important is that we use return on learning and return on investment. It comes further on. So return on learning is very important. You can fail, but you learn from it. The four concepts I just told you about, one of them we ended yesterday because it failed, so I'm very curious if you might know which one. but we learned a lot from it. It's maybe not a success for now, but it can be a success in the future, or we can improve our current services by learning from this concept. And this timeline helps us, but also helps other organizations, other libraries, and that's why we also created an innovation training. We want to know, we really want every library to be part of this design thinking method. We really want everyone to be working with design thinking, to be to know what your users want, because I think that's the future, that's where we are going to. So the next one is in November. If you're interested, please let me know. There are a few spots left. And that's it. Very quick, but that's it.
Thomas. Indeed, you had more time, but I'm sure maybe we didn't. You were not at breakfast.
No, I weren't.
You were not at breakfast. No. But maybe you...
I have more time for questions now.
Yeah, you still have a question for the audience, maybe.
Because we are working with brainstorming, so we want to know what people dislike or what they don't like, what they want. I have a question. What do people maybe don't like about this method? Are people who think, no, it wouldn't work for us? Or because it's very interesting, because then we can improve what we are doing. Other people maybe think, no, that's not for me, or brainstorming, why? What do you don't like about
yes,
it?
Yes, that's one of me.
I think a difficulty could be that you immediately get into a bad mindset.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Instead of thinking positive, you will be thinking negative, and that can influence the way you're thinking.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a nice
And who are you? Where are you from?
Sorry. My name is Lisette. I'm mm-hmm. from the library in Amstelveen.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good thing that you're telling me that, because we get that response a lot. Like, but then people only think about, no, I don't like this, and why should I come to the library? And it gets very negative. We use painstorming to know what people's pains are, but also their needs. So, of course, there will be a balance between the negative and the positive way of asking these people the questions, because it has to end positively, of course, at the end. So we ask them what their pains are, but we always end up with the need, so with a sort of solution so that the pain can go away, and that makes it positive. Yeah.
More answers to this? Or do you have a question for Wieske? Questions?
I'm
yes?
Curious. Which one stopped? You said one of
them stopped. Yeah, but which one do you think?
I think the first
Yeah, that's true.
That's what people don't want. Yeah,
they liked it, but for us it took a lot of time because we are riding our bicycles ourselves through Eindhoven to deliver the boxes and to pick them up. Very interesting because you can you get contact with your users directly. You can ask them, how do you like it? Do you like the service? Do you want different books? But it took us more time than what we returned. So yeah, we have to stop for now, but we learn from it because now we can improve our current delivery service. We can improve it by learning from the responses to this concept. But Verse Leeswaar stopped, yeah.
But what were the responses? Because my experience is that people are very hesitant about mm-hmm. things.
Yeah.
But if you give them appetizers yeah. about first chapters, they're very willing and very keen yeah. to have those.
Yeah. Yeah, well, we thought the target group for this concept would be young adults, or maybe people who just started a family, the same target group as for HelloFresh boxes, maybe. So we tested it over there, and everyone's, great, nice. And as soon as we put it out with a prototype, the more elderly people were interested. Yeah, they have the time. When I come over, they were like, oh, do you like a cup of coffee? Come in, please tell me about your job. So it was more the social aspect that they liked. So that was a big learning process for us, yeah.
So there is a need for people coming to elderly people to talk to them.
I think so, yeah.
We already knew that.
Yeah,
More questions over there.
My name is Marianne de Kort from Bibliotheek AZ.
Mm-hmm.
I have an assumption that Expeditie Anton is a small group of people inside. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's I checked it. It's right. first, I heard Sitzel talking about how design thinking should be all through the organization. Yeah. Do you have any difficulty spreading your ideas?
Yeah, that's our biggest challenge, because the innovation team Expeditie Anton started in 2016, and on purpose it was put out a little bit further from the current organization, because then we could we can create things and don't have to ask for permission or whatever. We can just operate freely. But now we are struggling with the challenge how to implement this into the organization, because we especially at the beginning, people looked at us like, oh, they're these young new people, they are telling us what to do, and we don't want that. So it's our biggest challenge, but it's getting better, because especially with Relibrary, nobody wants to throw books away, and if we have a solution for that, then you can get some sort of connection with the colleagues. But it's our biggest challenge, yeah, it is.
Hermien Lankhorst, Kunst van Lezen. I have a question actually for...
Hello.
For all three speakers, I don't know if that's possible, because one of the things that I'm really wondering about, you are all talking about how this design thinking is customer, the customer is central.
Mm-hmm.
And when you talk to them, you really try to find out what their need is.
Yeah.
And it often happens that they can't really express their own need right away. And I wonder, there seems to be quite a lot of translating or interpreting going on between mm-hmm. what you hear and then what you start to do in the design thinking process.
Yeah.
Have you come up with that? You have come up with something, a great idea, and that the customer doesn't really recognize their need in what you in the solution that you've come up with.
So a different solution for the problem that was presented, basically. I think that's what you mean.
Well, yes. In the interpretation between what you hear and what you think that the need is, do you come up with solutions that aren't really helping the customer?
Yeah, of course. And if so, it's very important to just test it out very quickly after you questioned or asked these people. So if you start with a prototype, you get around maybe the same people you spoke to earlier. And if you test it out, you can check if, is this what you want? Is this what we understood? And if they said, no, this is totally not what we understood, then you can improve and then you can maybe reinvent your concept. So it's all about testing and keeping them close. So if you have a prototype or a product, you can ask them again and again. And every time you make an improvement, ask them again. It's not like you're making it, like previous presentation said, you're not making it for them, but with them. That's a very important part of it, yeah.
Yeah, I totally agree. That's also the way we do it. And I think that it's very important when you translate something, you hear something and you translate it into a prototype and then you test it out. And sometimes we see that from all the things you have heard from the users, you come up with this idea and everyone think you fall in love with that idea. That's you really have to think about not doing that.
And
also think about the prototypes, not as this is not the final product at all. This is, again, it's just a learning tool to try to translate some of it. Is it kind of this way we are going? And then, no, it's not. And we have had many, many prototypes that had not met the needs of the users. So it has been like, okay, that was not the way to go. And also because you often, when you are out seeking inspiration, talking to users, sometimes you only talk to 3 or 5 users. So it's not representative for all the needs in your communities, but it's a starting point. So that's how you kind of get some inspiration and start going. So, and that's also why you have to go to many, many, many iterations before you get there, because you will fail a lot of time and lots of the prototypes will be failures. But that's the point, I guess.
Yeah.
Answer your question? Yes. Maybe time for one. Oh, there's more than
that. Yeah, hello. I'm Saskia Franke from Utrecht University Library.
Mm-hmm.
We have an innovation program, and we are started with prototypes, and we are learning a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm very interested, when do you... how do you get from prototyping to realization? When do you take that step? And we are a bit struggling with it. When do we end prototyping?
Yeah.
So maybe you can give some ideas.
Yeah.
Actually, the question is for all three ladies.
Yeah.
Again, give them to Sam.
So it's like, when is it enough? When is it good enough to realize? Yeah. For that, we use a method, one metric that matters. And... we use testing and learning cards. So we have a few types of, how do I explain? You have a few test phases, or how do you call it? And we write them down. We fill in our test cards. We think that, and we think that maybe vers leesbare will be... interesting for young adults. That can be a test. We have we are right, of course. We are right if young adults will buy this product, and we use one test per time per phase, because if you use use different tests at the same time, you will never know the results of which tests will be what will be the result of it. But I don't know if I can give you a direct answer from when it's never. I think it's some sort of feeling, and if you use, if you ask your target groups and you keep them involved, at some point you find a connection, and it's for us okay, and for them it's okay, and then you can, I think just realize it and then test on later. But I think it's never enough or something. It can always improve, and that's okay. I think that's my answer.
Yeah, I would just like to add that we also like to see the library as an ongoing prototype. So you will never finish. You will, of course, get to some implementation, but still, it's like it would be nice to someday say, now we're done. More innovation. But it will not stop. So the whole library space is an ongoing prototype that will change all the time. And of course, for some services, you need to go from it being a prototype to actually find the way to implement it. And there are, I think in the toolkit, we have described a few tools to help you. And also, I think we have some stories on the website that describes us a little bit, but I'd rather see it like it's ongoing. It will never stop. So, yeah, that's where we are.
Anya, you have anything to add to this? Or? No, no, this is it. Okay, last question. Last question, yes.
Mirjam van der Bremen, Bibliotheek Het Groene Hart. Library of the Green Heart. Sounds more interesting in English. I have a question. We've been talking about innovations and about new things and about prototyping and bringing in them into action. But is parting from things you do also a phase in your process? Because I can't think that it's just adding more services and more things to your library. Yeah. You have to say goodbye to things you have been, you have been doing for many years. So, how is that process of that phase part of the process you're going through?
Yeah, I think for a lot of people it can be very scary. Because you're changing, and change is scary for some people. Is it still on?
Yeah.
Okay. But if I understand your question correctly, you want to know how do you let go of things? Or?
No. You are. Is it on? Yeah.
Yeah.
Your group is thinking about new things, and if I know the situation about Eindhoven Library, I know there's not a tree with money in it, so you have to make choices.
Yeah.
What do we do? So what do we add? Yeah. And what do we take? Say goodbye to? Because there's not more people, there are not more financial resources to keep adding to what you're doing. Yeah. So in the process of innovating, there's also the process of killing your darlings or saying goodbye to things you have been doing. So how is that part, how is that process part of your process?
Maybe Versailleswaren is an example, because it costs us more than we would return. But we are mostly focusing on new things. But the Relibrary example, it's a new way of selling these books. But selling these books was already a service we provided, so it's sort of new, but it's improving a current service, and that's also very important, because not all things that are new are good. It also can improve your current services, and then you make a choice. Versailleswaren, we made the choice to stop, but we learned from it to improve our current delivery services. And Relibrary, we are improving our selling the books. So. I'm not sure how to explain how letting go will be part of the process, but I think it's important to know that not everything that is new or is innovative is good always.
I think we should do this.
I understand that, but
no, I understand. But let's do this in the break. We have delicious sandwiches afterwards waiting outside. But first, I want to take a moment because, like we said earlier, the printer managed to get the copies in time to this place. And Wieske, I want to ask Chantal. Chantal Verwey, are you here? Can you get to the stage? Because just very shortly, briefly, something about making this before we officially hand it over. Chantal.
Yes.
Chantal is from the Inspiratiebrigade. Have you ever heard something? I want to work at the... I'm moving to the Inspiration Brigade. Chantal, can you tell us a little about your involvement in making this beautiful thing? And maybe Wieske after that also.
Yes, well, we got a question from Grietje Smit, who is also here, to make a translation to the Dutch language from the Design Thinking Toolkits, but not only translated to Dutch, but also translated to the current situation. And we took on that challenge. And actually, it was kind of a bigger challenge than I could have imagined, than I assumed it. Yeah. Because I didn't realize how much effort will go into translating it to the Dutch. Mm. Not only making it perfect Dutch, but making it valuable to you as librarians. So we had a lot of discussions about, do you keep the word iteratie, or do you make it another word? So we had a lot of semantic discussions. And it took some more time than we thought, but here it is, and I'm really happy to be able to give all these people the tools at hand to start with design thinking.
And what was your role in short?
Well, I did help the translation, but I think it was a big team that helped the translation because in the end we wanted to test it with librarians, so Wieske took on a role.
I have a mic.
Oh, you have a mic.
Yeah. Yeah. Both.
I'd like to share.
Because Expeditie Anton already uses design thinking, and we learned from the English version. So we got a copy of the translated version, and we just checked if everything was correctly with the way we use it, or maybe we have some recommendations of how we use it or how we experienced it. So we looked at the choice of words or phrases, if it was correctly for us, if we understood what the toolkit was asking of us. So that was our part of the translation.
It's really a group effort.
Yeah.
Group
effort. Yeah.